Okay, can you please give us your full name and date of birth?
Yes, JoAnne McFadden Roosevelt, and I'm 55. I was born in November 1937.
Okay. Can you tell us some of your family background, how your family came to Sylvan Beach?
As I understand it, my mother, Josephine Hanchett McFadden Hartman, family started coming up in approximately 1924, and they stayed at what is now Potter area. It was Potter's Resort. And then a few years later, they bought a home on South Shore Drive, which it's at 6923 South Shore Drive. Very lovely two-story home. It's kind of a light orange with a wrought iron fence around it, about eight doors away from the golf club. And my father's family came up from Chicago, and they stayed at Partridge's Resort. And approximately in 1926, they bought what is known as the McFadden Cottage on the Michigan side.
Okay, well, that's fascinating.
And then my sister Jean was born in my mother met my father up here.
Okay, that's great.
Yes, and actually my father was dating my mother's older sister, Jane, and but he married mother. And my older sister Jean and I and Bonnie and Carol have been coming here all our lives. In fact, I've not missed a summer. I missed one summer in 1965, the summer that Elizabeth, our daughter, was born. But other than that, I've just been here all along.
Can you tell us some of the other family members? You mentioned Jean and there's Carol.
Yes, Joe and John McFadden had four girls, Jean, Joanne, Bonnie, and Carol. And two of the four of us have married boys that we met at White Lake as well.
Okay.
And in fact, on the other side of our family, Tony's side of the family, my father dated Ruth Googans as a teenager as well. She came up here all of her life. So our children, Tony and I, our children are the fifth generation on both sides of the family, on three sides of the family.
You mentioned Ruth Googans. Can you tell us something about her?
Her family was from Chicago. The Googans family was from Chicago, and her family's business was meat packing plant, the Swift, Googans Swift and Company. And Joseph Googans was raised in Chicago, and he married Josephine from Davenport, Iowa. And they lived in Chicago for a few years after they were married, and their two sons, John Googans and David Googans, were born and raised in Chicago and came up here. And then when Joseph Googans took the Swift and Company plant down to the Southwest, he moved to Fort Worth, and that's where Ruth Googans was born.
Okay. And
but they continued to come up here all those years.
And Ruth married somebody very famous. Can you tell us anything?
Yes. In 19, oh dear, I think it was probably 32, she married President Roosevelt's third child, second son, Elliot. And Elliot was on a business trip to Fort Worth from Washington, D.C., and just happened to be paired on a blind date with this cute little Ruth Googans. And they were married a few months later. And Elliot stayed down in Dallas. Excuse me, they stayed down in Fort Worth until the time of their divorce, 12 years after they were married.
Okay. Did you ever meet the president?
No.
You did meet his wife.
Yes, yes.
And she was a very gracious person.
Oh, she was a wonderful, wonderful person. She really was. She was a marvelous grandmother and to her 11 grandchildren at the time. And I was very conscientious and took them on trips and just would have them up to Hyde Park for the summer to visit. She was very, very caring.
To Sylvan Beach, so what did you do when you first came up here during the summer? What was the first thing you did when you arrived at your cottage?
Oh, we were just so glad to be out of the car. We would just probably unload the car and then we'd just run down to the beach. That seemed to be
the beach.
Just run out to the front of the cottages and look and go on down in the sand.
Okay.
But we were here for 3 months always. It was not the way it is now. Families at that point would just come up and stay and for a good 3 months.
Okay. What was your first memories of White Lake, Sylvan Beach? What memories? earliest?
Earliest memories? I remember just wonderful, long, lazy, sunny days on the beach with my sisters and our other playmates. And the mornings would be spent down at the dock with swimming lessons. And then in the afternoons, after our lunch and rest, nap, we'd all go down to the beach and stay there for forever, it seemed. And then we'd come up, and I remember Mother would always dress the four girls, four of us, very, very much alike, four little matching dresses usually. And I remember very clearly walking down for dinners at the Sylvan Beach Resort.
At the
Sylvan Beach Hotel, which was just a few doors, well, maybe eight doors away from our house. Seemed like a wonderful long walk, though, at that time.
Yes, must have been just mm-hmm. a
long. I remember that, and swimming lessons down at the dock.
Who taught you?
I don't remember. A variety of people. I remember Dolly Morton once was our teacher. We'd have, at the end of the summer, we'd have what we called Sylvan Beach Days, I think, and it was just kind of the wrap-up to all the summer activities of 2 months. And Ben Field had recently married Ann Field, and he was the clown. He was always dressed up, and I remember he'd have balloons and clown makeup, and he'd be fully clothed in his clown outfit as he jumped off the end of the diving board. And we'd have watermelon wrestles. They'd grease the watermelon, and we'd all jump in and try to, whoever got the watermelon, it was hard to get, obviously, could eat it. But I remember feeling like I was going to drown in the process quite a bit. It was not my favorite sport. And I remember another wonderful memory was going down to the arcade, which was where our swimming lessons took place. And they had several little stores. One was a ice cream parlor, and we'd have ice cream cones. And then there was a little gift shop with kind of dusty, mildewed cards, I remember. And all of a sudden, it left. There was a Coke machine, which somehow intrigued us all. I think it must have been somewhat new in our lives. And I remember one afternoon, one little boy got his arm stuck up the Coke machine and couldn't get it out. It was very exciting. I can't remember, poor guy, what happened, but I think an ambulance was called to extract his arm, but that was very exciting.
Do you remember who that was?
No, I have no idea. None at all. None at all. And I remember the people that managed the Sylvan Beach Hotel were the Myers. That name just popped in my head, and they had a son, Gene, who had red hair and was a contemporary of ours. He probably was 9 and 10 when we were 5 and 6, but we all kind of had a crush on him. I guess that's why I remember. I don't know. But we were very sorry when the Myers moved all the way into Whitehall, so we didn't see him anymore.
Oh, boy. Was the hotel torn down about what year?
I really don't remember.
Okay. Do you associate any smells with Sylvan Beach? White Lake, do you associate any?
Dead fish.
Dead fish?
Sorry. We used to just have to dodge all these little spiny fish, white fish, on the beach all the time. We would, they were just always there. And then, you know, sometimes if the wind and the waves didn't wash them back or they got buried in the sand, it was a definite fish odor on the beach. I was thinking another memory of the beach was the two pump houses down in front of the Dupree's, which at the time, I think it was Mr. MacGyver's home. He was a jolly, white-haired, white-bearded man that lived there. And I don't know why I remember Mr. MacGyver, but there were two pump houses in front of his house. And I do believe there were stairs that went down. Association might have had another pair of stairs. Kind of remember that. And one of our activities would be beach parties once a week down on the beach and capture the flag games. And I think the pump houses were very rather threatening looking. You know, they were all just very old, and the glass on the windows was broken, and we tried to kind of avoid those. But they were wonderful for our hide-and-go-seek games and our capture the flag. But as the years went on, they just kind of became buried in the sand. Huh. Foundation remains on one now, but it brought back a lot of memories when that foundation kind of appeared.
Yeah, yeah.
10 years ago.
Oh, yeah, when that washed
yes,
the storm. Yes,
yeah.
You mentioned the little schools of fishing. Do you see those nowadays? down there? You mentioned schools of fish. It's something that's...
Oh, I didn't mean schools of fish. Just fish that would wash up. Yes. And I think this was the beginning of when they introduced coho salmon to Lake Michigan, was to eat up these little... Weren't they alewives?
Yeah.
They were always around until recently. It's unusual now when you see fish washed up on our beach. Yeah,
although they are dying off south of here.
Yes, I understand.
So who knows what's going on.
Oh, and I remember shuffleboard at the Forbes house, which prior to the Forbes owning it was the Chittenden's, Mrs. Pearson's brother, Loker Chittenden's home. And there was a concrete slab, and there was shuffleboard painted on, and we'd get out there and play shuffleboard. And the other day, in walking past the Forbes, which is now the Schaefer's home, I saw that concrete and hadn't thought about shuffleboard games in 45 years.
And it was that same concrete?
Yes, same. Paint's all washed off, but if anyone wants a recreation, they can paint it back on.
Paint it back on. The simplest things in life are...
But that was a fun memory, too.
That's neat. Who were some of the, in your opinion, or just some of the people you remember as being the outstanding sailors, tennis players, male and female?
Well, tennis players, I remember Mr. and Mrs. Terryberry played a lot of tennis, and they were there, and Ann Wisnam's mother, Mary Helen Burroughs, was on the tennis court for many, many years, and not too many others played. I just remember that group.
But there wasn't many playing.
No, it was golf. I remember my parents played golf constantly, and their golf cronies were Homer Hartz and a Duttenhofer, that group of Art Children. But the sailors were, of course, Al Youngquist, Sr., was a wonderful, wonderful person. And we would spend a lot of time at the yacht club, of course, in those days. And his son and the son's friends, Al Youngquist, Bruce Stewart, Doug Partridge, Joe Partridge, Bob Christie, Mary Lynn Mulder, Andreessen, Bob Christie, Tom Getz, they were all just that much older than I, but they were such a nice bunch of kids. Really great, wonderful teenagers to try to emulate.
Oh, yes. Yeah, so they were good sailors, too?
Yes. I don't know how good they were, but they did a lot of it.
Well, certainly young Tom Getz.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Christy Bob was always good. That's fascinating.
And Bill Hodson. How could I have forgotten Bill Hodson? He was a wonderful, wonderful person.
A real loss.
Mm-hmm.
A real loss. He was a wonderful person, too. Can you tell me something of the summer romances up here? Give me a few, for instance.
Well,
you and Tony were...
Tony and I, and Jim McCall marrying my younger sister Bonnie, and Bonnie had just idolized Jim McCall from afar ever since the McCall family first came up here, and I wish I could tell you the year, but Bonnie was far too young to even think about going out on a date, so... Actually, they had their first date when Tony and I had our first date. It was after a junior yacht club meeting, and who knows what year, probably 1953. And that meeting was over at 8 o'clock, and so Tony could drive. No one else could. And he thought, he asked me if I'd go in to see a movie. And I said, I'd love to. And I checked with my mother, and then Jim McCall was there. And Tony said, come on, Jim, why don't you come too? And Jim turned to Bonnie and asked her, and she was just delighted. It's been a fun memory to think that shared that.
To have a watershed date like that.
Yes,
that would,
yes.
Yes, it would actually work out. Can you tell me some of the outstanding jinxes and jinx skits that you can remember?
There were
some memories you had?
I remember one, of course, this couldn't be done today at all. But again, it was that group, I think, of Bruce Stewart, Margot Tukey, Dodden, they blacked their faces and they all wore white. It was a takeoff on Al Jolson, Mammy, and they had black hands and white outfits, and it was wonderful. There were wonderful numbers then. Another one was the Mississippi Mud number. Again, you couldn't use it as it was done when we were growing up. It was racist. Yeah. But I remember that number, and I remember another number with, again, that group, Bruce Stewart and Dwayne Pearson, and they were in Hawaiian hula skirts and Hawaiian hats, and I don't know what they did, but I remember they did that. And there was another number when everyone was up on the stage. The whole Jinx was, all the cast was up on stage all the time because the setting was a barn. And I have a picture of actually Bonnie and Carol McFadden, and they couldn't have been older than 4 and 6, sitting on bales of hay, along with, what was his name? Doug Crampton? No, that wasn't his name. The Crampton boy. John Howell, Margot Tookie, or Margot Hodson Tookie, and Dick Dennison. And it was just memorable to me because all the different acts were together doing a couple of numbers.
Wow, that's a good idea.
Yeah, yeah.
I think they did that this year, too.
And the theme was a square dance, as I remember. And everyone was participating in some sort of a barn type of a number.
And you don't even remember the song.
No. But I was 11. I remember that. And B. Van Inenem, Margot Reitz, Dave Van Inenem, Buster Diamond, Tom Panyard. We all were, Marvel on a Wet, all of us were up there together in that one particular number. I don't think Carl had arrived on the scene yet.
Okay.
Carl came a little later. But as time went on, Carl directed the Jinx for 2 different numbers when he was in college, and I was his assistant, and we had a wonderful time. I can't tell you what we did.
What you did?
No, no idea. I have no idea of the numbers or even the themes. But he was wonderful to work with because he brought a different technical aspect to the Jinx.
Yeah.
That was fun.
Very brilliant man. Very brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
What are some of the... in your life up here, White Lake and Sylvan Beach, some of the most notable characters, memorable characters.
Memorable, well, of course, Buster Diamond in our my era was just notorious, great guy. But you know, Buster.
Yeah.
One of my memories of Buster is, of course, he was driving long before legally he was allowed to, but that didn't seem to bother anyone. And he'd get in the car and then he'd put it in reverse at the tennis courts and just drive up or just back up all the way, you know. Anyway.
Yeah, I remember when I was a kid, he was always in those cars.
Oh, yes, yeah.
Sailing his E-boat, too, I remember that.
Yes, he made life very exciting. He really did.
Yeah.
And
plus, he was a very good person, too. He was just did things that, mm-hmm. you know, that weren't harmful, I don't think. That was certainly a loss, too, because he did die in a car.
That's right. That's right.
So that was too bad. Going over to the yacht club, who were your sailing school peers and teachers? Who did you go to sailing school with?
Well, I think Bill Onowet was there a lot, and Tom Getz was one of my instructors. And Al Youngquist. I remember those vividly, but we started, yes. And then the Sellers came up, and I wish I could remember the year. I think perhaps early 1950s.
50s.
And Nan Sellers had a wonderful boat. It was a winner. You got in that boat, and it just won everything. And I crewed for Nan. B. Van Inenem and I crewed for Nan. And it was just a wonderful couple of years. Everyone loves being a winner.
Yes.
We were definitely the winners. And then I got a Y flyer, and mine was always last. I don't know why. It just was, and I didn't really care. I just enjoyed being out there.
Yeah. It was just the fun of the whole thing.
The fun of it all, and it was a huge fleet. We had quite a number of boats. Nancy Yeoman, Dick Marvel, why do I think he had a Y? I don't know that he did.
Yeah.
The Lanawets, we just had a lot of fun on Thursdays and Saturdays. Wonderful way to spend time.
Oh, God, the happiest time of my life. Did Nancy Yeoman have the Y-5?
She had the Y-5, the Mad Plaid. I think everyone might remember the boat. It was painted in a plaid, reds, yellows, greens, blues. Very colorful.
in late in its life, I can remember the tire on the front of the Y-Flyer that they would use.
Oh, yes.
Tires that they would use for bumpers that were permanently on the bow of the the wine?
Well, our boat was called One for All, because it was one for the four girls in our McFadden family, but the other three didn't really like sailing. So it was really all for me, as it turned out. However, my father, I had no way to get out to our Y-Flyer. I'd just kind of have to get a little ride in someone's putt-putt all the time. And so my mother said, John, you really should get a little putt-putt for JoAnne, or a rowboat or something. And so he agreed that would be a good idea. So he came back from Pillinger's, not with anything I could use to get out to my Y-Flyer. He came back with one of those wonderful mahogany criss-crafts. And I still had a problem getting to my sailboat, but my father at least could watch the races from his boat. He loved it. And he named that one All for One. So we were All for One and One for All, which was a fun memory.
Yeah, no kidding. Mm-hmm. How long did you have the criss-craft?
Oh, we still have it.
You still have it?
Uh-huh. Yes, Mother's never been able to part with it. It's in dry dock, and one of these days we really want to get it out and have it floating again, fix it up. And,
yeah, one of the kids maybe might want to do that.
Oh, someone. Our kids are very mechanical, so it might happen very soon.
And those things are worth a lot. Uh-huh. Too. In your life, what are some of the social changes or changes that have taken place around here?
I think that's the beauty of it all. There have been some changes, but physically this has remained the same, and the people have remained the same, and it's one of the beauties of Sylvan Beach, I think, is that it has been so constant.
Yes. Could you describe a typical day and night when you were a teenager here at White Lake? Could you take us through a day?
Well, of course, the older we got, the later we'd sleep, but that's, I think, during our teenage years, our days were a little shorter or different. Okay. The structure was different.
Well, let's take a day, like, for instance, a Thursday on a junior yacht club and the race and sailing.
Well, again, we'd all kind of be down at the dock for whatever activities. And as we got older, afternoons were always on the beach, no matter what age you were. And then in the evenings, of course, dinner, and then you go to the yacht club and see your friends. But that really was only on Thursday evenings. And on Wednesdays, for many, many years, they had square dances at the yacht club. And I remember Mr. Fritz Neumeister, do I? And Lynn Wagner, and they were wonderful because those Wednesday night square dances, because you got to meet other people that you would never have known.
Yes.
From around the lake. And I think this is really where we first became friends with Dick Marvel and the Goodspeeds and people that did not live in the association. You met at the yacht club, and then as everyone got older, we'd know them through the junior yacht club activities and then sailing school. So our group expanded as we got older, and then in the evenings, again, when we were, I'd say, at least 13 or 14, we'd all gather on the beach, and wonderful, wonderful times. People would tell stories, and we'd play games, capture the flag games, and they're really... Other than Buster Diamond bringing down his six-pack of beer, no one was there for that reason. They were there for the camaraderie, and we did have deadlines. I remember one in particular. Our group of parents started the Maytags, and that was short. That was the abbreviation for Mothers Association for Young Teenage Girls. And they kind of would get together and set the rules so that there was no, so it was very equitable. Everyone really had the same kind of curfews. And
couldn't run to each other's parents.
Couldn't do that, right. And so that was good. I think everyone appreciated those guidelines very much. And we'd never think not to, we'd always go by them.
Yeah. Well, you were too scared not
to. Right. We just never questioned it. It's just what we did.
You mentioned a name, Fritz Neumeister. I remember a picture of him that used to be up at the yacht club for years. He always worked in the kitchen, didn't he?
I don't know that. I have no idea. I just remember he's such an enthusiastic dancer.
Well, you know, it's funny you mention that, because it's the square dance night that he died. I was sitting right next to him when he had his heart attack.
Oh, I didn't even know that.
Yeah, he died at the square dance.
Oh, well, how...
Which was kind of neat.
That's nice.
You know? Yeah.
But
that's funny you mentioned that name, because that was, God, when I was just a little kid and I was sitting right next to him and he keeled over.
Oh, that must have been slightly traumatic.
As a child, it's, you know, it's, oh, gee, what's going on? You know? But But it's funny you mention that name. I haven't thought of him in a very long time.
Speaking of activities, another highlight to our summer during those early years that went on, I think, really into my teenage years was Curve Crest Skating Party. The rink is at the end of Giles Road and Whitehall Road, and it was just a highlight of our summer.
I used to hear stories about that, Now, what did you go as a group?
The whole association. I don't know if it was given by a few quiet benefactors or if it was just an association activity, but everyone was there, and they had an area where the people could watch. Our senior citizens would come. Everyone turned out. And everyone was on skates or watching, but I think the whole association was represented. It was wonderful. We looked forward to that for years and years and years. And
do you remember when that was torn down or how long that?
I think Kirkcrest, it was torn down, wasn't it?
Was it?
They sold it.
Business, yeah.
I think the structure is there. And it's I saw it the other day thinking, my goodness, it's not as big as I remembered.
Do you have any idea when that place stopped doing that?
I probably was 1952 or 3, I would think. But I don't remember when they didn't do it. So I think it was something I did always until...
All the way through the year. Do you remember any of your junior Commodores?
Oh, yes.
Can you tell us about some of them?
Well, I just remember... I don't know, but we looked up to them all. You know, I think you became a junior when you were age 11, but you couldn't be a Commodore till you were 18, I think, 17.
It was generally about that age that you
so
became.
So I think those of us who were very new juniors would just look up at this older group of men, or mid-teenagers, and I can't remember who they were, but very much that same group I mentioned, Sam Stewart, Dacre Pearson. I don't know that he was a junior Commodore, but Dick Marvel, but that he was my contemporary.
Right.
And Dave Van Enenum.
Okay, could you describe what you would do on a rainy day when you were a
teenager? Oh, I don't remember those rainy days, and I'm sure we had them.
So you probably just did what everybody else did.
But I do remember it was a very active activity during June and or July and August down at the dock, and that we'd have a lot of arts and crafts. And on rainy days, if we weren't down there taking our swimming lessons or swimming, we just have a lot more arts and crafts, weather permitting. I mean, not weather or not, didn't matter. We would do that if we couldn't be swimming. There was always someone, some activity in the morning. But I really don't remember the others.
We've talked about the old ski ramp. Can you tell us something about that?
Oh, God, it was the most dangerous thing. I did not water ski at that point in time, but it was fun to watch Buster Diamond. I think it was privately owned by the Diamond family. And I remember Tom Panyard and Buster Diamond and Buster's sister, Margot. Is it Margot? Is that right?
There was Helen and Margaret,
Margaret, that's Margaret, it. Yeah. I just remember them going over it all the time, and it just always, sometimes they made it, and when they didn't make it, it was never bad. You know, they'd kind of slide off, but it was taken down, I believe, after Margaret really had a terrible fall on it.
Yeah.
She was badly injured, but it was exciting and kind of frightening at the same time.
Did you ever jump at your
ski? No, I didn't ski at that point.
You didn't ski?
No. But I probably would have had I known how to ski.
Yeah.
And it seemed to be so big. It just was wonderful to watch, and they all were quite good at it.
Mm-hmm. Can you tell us something? Your brother-in-law and his father, Ted Edson and Mr. Edson, can you tell us anything about Mr. Edson? Any memories of that? He's very done very many things in his life.
Yes. As I said, that Ruth Guggins Roosevelt came up as a child. Well, and then after she married Elliot Roosevelt, she came up a couple of times with him. They would rent houses, and I remember hearing at one point that they rented George Hartman's house, and their Secret Service men had to be housed someplace, and it was, as I have heard, very disruptive to the beach. To have that happen, and I remember, I don't remember this. I was approximately 2 and Tony was 3, and there are pictures of us all down on the beach together. But that was my first meeting with Tony. And his sister was 5. And I just remember hearing stories later about Elliot Roosevelt was just such a forward, avant-garde man. He was the only man on the beach without a top to his bathing suit. And he wore had tasseled shoes. And anyway, they thought he was really fast. But then their marriage ended, and after about 12 years of marriage, and she married Harry Edson, who had flown with Elliot Roosevelt during the war. And they were married, I think, in 1945, 46. And at that point, they started coming back up here and renting houses. And then they ended up buying the former John Nevine Sr.'s home,
okay,
which is now the Bowens house.
And that is actually, as far as I know, the only house on Sylvan Beach with a plaque on it saying
yes,
it's the Ruth
yes.
Edson house. It's the only place.
Yes. Well, after she and Harry were married for 30 years, she died in 1974, so they were married in 1944. That was it. And after her death, she died very suddenly up there, and he just never really, he could shut the door, and he didn't come back.
Yeah.
The memories are there, but it was just, I think, a difficult thing for him.
Yeah, married again.
And we, of course, their 4 children inherited the house, and at that point in time, we all were very concerned about living in it because of the bank erosion, and we felt it was a tremendous liability. So this is why we're no longer there, and fortunately it worked out beautifully for the Bowens to have the house, and it's secure.
It's
staying on the hill.
Going to your house here that's in the background, could you give us some background on your house here, the history of it?
I remember as a child, the sidewalks, as you know, went all the way down the front of all these houses. And this house had the sidewalk in front of it, and then there was a cyclone fence with morning glories that grew up it, and it was just, I love morning glories. But anyway, that's how the house looked at the time I was a child. And Mrs. Stewart took out the sidewalk because she had so many strangers that they'd just walk up from Murray's or whoever, wherever, and just to stand in her front yard all the time. And I guess after years of that, you get a little tired of that. So she took the sidewalk out, but the path also went on down the hill towards the Murray's Inn path. And we could, as children, we'd play over here frequently, and we'd play in the woods and go down this way to Murray's Inn. And it was indeed our very good fortune when in 1985, Mrs. Stewart came to Tony and said that she no longer wanted to keep up this home, and she and her children were not going to come up on a permanent basis, and they did not want to have the house either, and she'd like to sell it to him. And he was very delighted. So we were very fortunate to be able to expand into this lovely home.
Do you have any memories of any storms to you that were outstanding?
I really don't. The storms all were outstanding, as I remember, because the lights would always go out. And it was almost a fact. Every time we'd have a big storm, our lights would go out for matter, and the electricity as well. And it was always restored fairly rapidly, but we always kept a lot of candles around for that purpose. And no one had phones at that point in time, but the few people that did, the phones would stop working. So I think they've come a long way with electricity since then. But and I remember a good storm was when Jane Pelton's screens would blow off her porch. They would just be kind of over the bank and just in our McFadden yard and Stewart's hedge. And so we'd all collect them the next day. Yeah. That was a sign of a really good blow.
Yeah, when the screens were on.
Uh-huh.
That's fascinating. Can you give me, what weddings do you remember up here? What outstanding?
I wish I knew the year. I remember when Nancy Vandevender married Hugh Lilly, and Carolyn Berger's family lived, where the Ehlers family lived, and we ran up to the Berger's garage, and so we could overlook the wedding of the Van de Vender yard. And I remember that, and then not too long ago, 13 years ago, I remember Carol Ehlers was married up here. But really, then we had a daughter who was married up here 2 years ago. There were not too many, but the Nancy Van de Venders really stands out. And I bet that's been 42 years ago, at least.
Do you have any memories of the Second World War up here? Any rationing?
I remember coming up here feeling very removed from the war, because at home when I was 5 and 6 and 7, we'd have to put blackout screens, oilcloth, at our home in Evanston, Illinois, every night. Whenever it got dark, before you turned lights on, you just routinely would go through this procedure. And when we come up here, we didn't do that. So I think we all had a sense of relief and security up here.
Yeah.
But I do know when we'd hear planes, we all got a little nervous, but then that was, but I do remember that part of the war. We were slightly removed, of course, because they didn't have anything on television and the radio coverage was scant. It was really when you went to the movies and then they had that preview of the newsreel. That kept us current, but I remember rationing, and I remember gas rationing and sugar rationing. We'd have coupons, and if we accumulated enough coupons, we could go buy sugar, so we could make fudge up here. But those are my wartime memories. Oh, I remember when the war was over. All of a sudden, my mother was changing clothes, and she was, I think, before she put her dress on, she was in her full-length slip and running out of the house saying, the war's over, because everyone started honking and there was a symphony of horns and cars and everyone was pounding on their horns, and that was the reason. And there was a great, great joy. That was in July, 1945, when
probably be August.
The armistice was declared.
Yeah.
August 11th.
Yeah,
I think.
August, right.
Uh-huh, Armistice Day.
Yeah. Because the Germans gave up in April and the Japanese finally in August. Yeah, you're right.
So that was wonderful. It was a happy, happy memory.
Oh, yeah.
You remember that, don't you?
No, I wasn't there. But the Korean War, I do remember that coming to an end.
Yes, yes, I do too.
Do you remember the Korean War?
I remember the Korean War. Again, as I said, communications were not at all what they are today. And I remember hearing that Joe Partridge went to war. He was fighting in Korea, and I just always adore Joe because he was such a kind, friendly young man. And I don't know, he probably was 10, 12 years older than I, but he always spoke to me at the yacht club and was so friendly to everyone. And when I heard he was fighting in the Korean War, I was very concerned for him.
He came home,
and another memory I have, I heard he had landed on U.S. soil, and within half an hour in San Francisco, his wallet was pickpocketed, and he didn't have it. And he thought, what a welcome.
Yeah. Especially.
And then also, Tony's grandmother took Tony and Chandler to Europe that summer, and they were going to spend most of the summer over there. They were traveling in Norway, and they were staying at the palace of Prince Olaf, who had teenagers Tony's age and Chandler's age. They were 13 and 15 at the time. And the Korean War broke out, and so their grandmother quickly departed for the United States with them in tow, because she certainly didn't want to be over there. So that was another memory of Korea.
Do you have any memories of Jack Braga?
Yes, I do.
Can you tell us
I do.
About
he was a very, what would you say? If I had to describe what a pirate looked like, I'd say Jack DeFrager looked like a pirate. He wore things on his head, didn't he? Wear these bandanas tied in his head or on his neck or something, and he was stocky. He was stocky and he was dark, and I think he was bearded. And I remember feeling slightly uncomfortable whenever I'd...
Intimidated.
That's my memory, and I had no idea. He personified, I guess, the old sailor. And not until we moved into the Stewart home, and I was... I found a map or a painting or something, a map. That Jap signed by Jack DeFraga. And up until that point in time, I had no idea that he had that talent.
Yes, and few of those around.
Really, to this day, that's all I know about Jack DeFraga. Too bad.
Yeah.
I have to learn more.
Well, you'll have to buy the film and learn more. Yeah. What do you remember of any Moonlight Sales, you remember?
I do. I remember Moonlight Sales, and I remember being slightly scared because you couldn't see anything. This had to be before I had my Y Flyer. I think they were in seas. Can you help me with that?
Yeah, probably were.
Seaboats?
Yeah.
And I remember going out with a lot, maybe there'd be six and seven of us on one particular boat. And I just remember the moon necessarily wasn't always out, and it wasn't all that bright. And I remember Buster Diamond and several others skiing, water skiing, at night.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
What, did they have lights on them or anything?
Oh, I think they must have. Must have had turned lights on the boat, but I don't know about, you know, towing the skier. I'm sure Buster didn't have any light on them. I have no idea. I think the Maytag Association did not like us doing that. We were not allowed.
Yeah. Yeah, I imagine the Maytag Association with Buster must have been...
Exciting. Well, I think that's why they had the Maytag Association, because of Buster.
Oh, that's great. Mm. Is the lake cleaner, do you think, now, or is it not as clean?
I think it is a lot cleaner. I remember many, many days in the summer when I was young, we couldn't swim in White Lake. And also in Lake Michigan, because of the pollen and the algae. It was green. Couldn't get near it. And I lifeguarded. I was a lifeguard probably in 1953 and 54, and having often, we just had a sign we'd put up, no swimming today, because we had a lot of green water, and I suspect it's a lot cleaner now. We don't have that.
That's
my gauge.
But
Hooker's closed. I can't believe we all survived swimming in Hooker water.
Yeah.
Polluted water.
I don't know if we did or not. I don't know what damage may have been done. I remember I used to drink out of that lake.
Of course. Another memory I have, you mentioned Michigan aromas, and the fish was one, and then the tannery leather.
Oh, the tannery leather?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, that tannery was
Yeah, really strong. Yeah. We'd stay inside a lot in those days. Really pungent.
Yeah, they cleaned that up.
Oh, yes. Everything's been cleaned up.
Yeah, so that's been a good trend. Do you remember the lake going up as high?
Yes,
as it
yes, yes.
Dropping. And
yes, I do.
What are some of the highs and lows? Do you remember?
I just remember as a child, there was a great expanse of flat white sand. It went out for. We could sit up here on our bluffs, and look down, and you could see the beach water. The dunes were not here, actually. The pictures I've seen, the dunes were not that prominent. Maybe they were.
You would sit here and see.
We could see sand a lot. Now, I don't know if the dunes are taller or in a different form, or it's because we don't have all that sand, but that definitely has changed. And we've all watched the houses being moved back, and we've moved our boathouse, the Hartman Boathouse, back on as far as it would go, thinking if the water keeps rising, what will we do?
Yeah.
And that problem has changed. So at this point, it's so cyclical. And if we live long enough, we're going to see it go higher and then, again,
lower.
Mm-hmm. Well, I do remember, though, as a child, and again, I want to say, I think I start remembering things when I was 4 and 5 years old, taking walks after having dinner at the Sylvan Beach Hotel or just after dinner, period. And we'd all walk all the way down to my mother's friend's house, Mim Butterfield. She was Mim Bartlett, and it was the Bartlett house, which is now known as the Buckingham House. And then the Statons, to my knowledge, has always been the Statons. But we'd walk all the way past the Dorts, which was then not the Dorts, And John Devine Sr. and the Bartletts and the Statons and even to the Freemans. I think we could walk to what is now the Dacies.
I'll be right on the block there.
Walk straight down, and there was a sidewalk. I think, not sure about the sidewalk, but where the Sylvan Beach Association, where the Sylvan Beach Hotel started, the sidewalk ended, and there was just kind of the walk through the woods, and then I think the sidewalk started again. Ah, maybe wrong.
That's fascinating.
And another wonderful memory of those years was at Mr. John Devine Sr.'s home, which, again, I just said is the Bowens, was the Edsons, is the Bowens now. He would have Sunday night story hours, and I think this went on for about 3 or 4 years, and all of us, from 5 on to 8 or 9 and 10, would go down for a story hour on Sunday evenings, and he would have popped a lot of popcorn, and we'd sit around on the floor at his feet, and he would tell marvelous stories. Don't ask me what they were. But he would sit in the interior room, which was wonderful, beautiful wood, and there was a chair that came out of a pillar built in. Yeah. And he'd sit there and tell us all these stories, and it was wonderful.
Yes. Did you read them from a book, or did you just tell them?
I think a combination.
A combination?
Combination of both. I remember Margot Hodson and Lucy Chilgren and that generation, we're all really the same, close to the same age, but 5, 6 years makes a big difference when you're 5 and 6 years old, but yeah. They were all there too.
Wow, that's fascinating. And that was the Edson guy, what was
it? Yes, yeah. The Navines, the Edsons, Harry and Ruth Edson bought it from John, from yeah. His estate.
Yeah, because that pillar's still there.
Mm-hmm. It is, yeah.
There.
Yeah.
Well, JoAnne, I think that's about it with this tape and with the other tape that we have. I think this is very good.
Good.
We
can
see you today, and that's what we wanted to do.
So. Well, I hope the memories are accurate.
I'm sure they are.
And that our children to come will all enjoy them. All the stories.
I think that's something we're glad we've done.
Good. You know, thank you, Joe, for doing it all.
Well, thank you. Seconds for it to catch up. Okay, JoAnne, can you give
yes.
me your full name and date of birth, please?
JoAnne McFadden Roosevelt. And I was born in November 1937.
Okay, can you tell me how your family came to White Lake Sylvan Beach?
Do you mean my particular family or my great grandparents?
Well, your great grandparents
All right.
would be a good place to start.
On both sides of my family and one side of my husband's family, but I'll start with the McFadden Hanschett angle. John McFadden's parents came up and stayed at what is known as Partridge's Bed and Breakfast or Little Inn, and they came up, I believe, about 1913 when my father was a little boy, and about approximately 1926 they bought the Hooton College, Marion Runyon's father's home, which is down from ours, just a few doors down, known as the McFadden Cottage Sunset Lodge. And my mother's family came up about 1920, and they were the Hanschetts. They purchased, again, they stayed at Partridge's, and this is how my McFadden branch of the family and the Hanschett branch came together. They all stayed at Partridge's, and my father actually dated the older Hanschett sister, Jane, but ended up marrying her younger sister, Josephine, in 1934. But that is how they came up. Eventually, the Hanschetts purchased a home on South Shore Drive near the Yacht Club, near the Keenans, actually.
Okay.
And they had that home until after the Depression. Then they sold it.
Which would be about 1940s?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Now, Mrs. Hatchett, your mother was Josephine Hatchett.
Josephine Hatchett.
It was Josephine Hartman.
Yes.
Okay.
Josephine McFadden.
Okay.
Married to John McFadden, then married George Hartman in 1960. They were married until his death in 1976.
Okay, can you tell us about your husband's side of the family?
My husband's side of the family originally was from Iowa. Their name was the Guggins, and they lived in Davenport, Iowa. They moved to Chicago, where Joseph Guggins became one of the co-owners of Swift & Company. It became Guggins Swift & Company. Joseph Guggins spent quite a bit of time in Chicago. Then he moved with his wife and two sons down to Fort Worth, Texas, to develop the Swift & Company, the Guggins Swift & Company plant down in the Southwest. And at the time he had two sons, John and David Guggins, and then Ruth Guggins was born to them once they had moved to Fort Worth. And they continued to come up to Sylvan Beach. In fact, they owned they rented the Marshall Cottage, which used to be on the White Lake side near the Pearsons, and it was one of those that burned in the fire.
Okay.
But Ruth Guggins married Elliot Roosevelt, and then after their divorce in 1948, I believe, right after the war, she married Harry Edson. And she and Harry bought a home, as you know, which is now owned by the Bowens. And they lived in that for about 14 years.
Okay. Can you tell us something about your husband?
Specifically, yeah. What would you... I'm sure you want more specific information. Well, he started coming up when they bought the home in 1950, and I think he was 13 at the time. Actually, I think they bought that home in 1949. And he started coming up when he was 12 or 13, and he was really much more of a cowboy. And my earliest recollection of him was roping sawhorses in the garage, the Edson garage. And we just had to coax him to come down to the beach. He was not a water beach person. He still is not. But there's something for everyone here, and he loves it because his family loves it so much and because of the rich heritage on all our sides. And our children are actually the fifth generation to come up here on both sides of the family, my side twice and his side once through the Guggins. So it's just so unique.
Yes, yes. When you met Tony, when Tony came up here, did you fall in love with Tony?
Oh, no. No, no. He was short and a little round, and but definitely a little unique. I'd never really known anyone from Texas, and he had a little accent, and he'd rope sawhorses in his garage, and all of us, Sam Post, Jim McCall, Ben Goodspeed, Dick Marvel, and I, and Margot Reitz and Bee Venning, and we just go down there and see what this roping was all about. We were quite interested in him and his habits and his Texas lifestyle. He went away to prep school to Andover in Massachusetts, and then one summer he came up and he was quite tall and quite thin, and all of us immediately, Bargo and Beeb and Nan Sellers, all of us just thought he was quite an interesting guy, and then very attractive also.
Very, very attractive.
Yes. And very, very nice.
Great. Being from the family of a president, did that cause problems? Were there guards or anything that you remember?
No, not at that point. Because when I met him, his grandfather was deceased. The moment his grandfather died in 1945, the Secret Service men disappeared just as quickly as they came. In fact, Harry Edson recalls hearing from Ruth, his wife, later, that all of a sudden they left. They didn't even have time to say goodbye. They just picked up and moved out very, very rapidly.
After all that time.
Yes. But I'd always known Tony, really, and his family. So Secret Service, he was just Tony Roosevelt.
Especially here.
And of course, my family were very, very staunch Republicans. And I think if I'd met Tony on any other turf, it would have been quite a problem. And that sounds so silly in this day and age to say politics would have mattered. But I think to my grandparents, they just felt Democrats they didn't really care to know any Democrats. So anyway, Tony was just Tony always to me.
Okay. When did you first begin to fall in love with Tony? I mean, when did you start to date up here? And Also, at that point in time, do you remember any other summer romances that were big in your age group?
Oh, quite a few, yes, and several marriages. Well, of course, there was Jim McCall, who was a buddy of mine up here, and a friend of Tony's, and he ended up marrying Bonnie McFadden, who had always adored Jim. And you know, when you're growing up, 1 year makes such a difference in your life. You're just doing, you're running with a different group. And Bonnie, being 2 years younger than me and Jim, really was not doing the same things we were doing. But she just sat on the sidelines and just adored him. And I remember one night, Tony could drive, because in Texas you got your driver's license earlier than you did in Illinois and Michigan. And Tony, we went to a drive-in movie, and Tony invited me, and I was quite excited that I had been singled out. And he said, Jim, why don't you just bring someone with you too? And Jim said, oh, well, Bonnie was right there. And he said, Bonnie, why don't you come? And of course, Bonnie just had always adored him, and that was their first date, and actually my first date with Tony. I can't tell you the movie, but anyway, Tony was 14 and I think I was 13. I can't believe we were on a car date at that age. Maybe we were 15 and 14, but anyway, it was memorable for both Bonnie and for me as well.
Okay, for a second to go back, what were the children in your family? Which Mrs. Hartman and then the other, can you break down?
Yes, John McFadden and Joe Hanchett, as I said, were married in 1934, and they had Jean, JoAnne, Bonnie, and Carol, and all of us are within 5 years.
Okay, so it all came from,
yes,
McFadden.
Yes, absolutely, John and Joe, and there were no other, it's fortunately uncomplicated.
Okay. Well, back to the movie date. How soon did things gel?
Oh, goodness. Well, I just was quite a fickle person. And I, when Tony was up here, I just thought he was wonderful, and I dated him. And then, of course, out of sight, out of mind, which I think is the way it should be at that age. So I'd go back to Illinois and had just enjoyed lots of other dates and then went off to college. But every summer I'd see Tony. And whatever boy I liked when I came up here, the moment I saw Tony, I didn't like the other one anymore. And so there was he was a constant in my life, always. Then I happened to go to the University of Colorado. He was at Colorado A&M, which was 60 miles up the road, because he was going to be a rancher. And of course we know that he is not. In fact, you know, until the day we were married, Tony Roosevelt wore cowboy boots and his custom-made cowboy shirts and cowboy pants, or Western cut pants, and I never really saw him in anything else. And of course, since the day we're married, I've never seen him in anything relating to the West or to the cowboy era. And it was quite an interesting thing that happened, but he just really had to start. He went to work in the land department of an oil company in Fort Worth, and really has never left the oil industry.
And I gather he's done very well, too.
Well, he's worked very hard, and he's been successful.
Great. And still doing quite
and,
well.
And, he loves what he does, and I think that's a wonderful gift.
Yes.
He
yes.
feels he has a lot more to accomplish.
Great.
So.
That's wonderful. Bonnie and Jim, can you tell, how long did that take to gel? Did they continue to date?
Always, as far as Bonnie was concerned, it gelled from the moment the McCall family came up here, and sorry I cannot give you that year. Bonnie just always adored him, and Jim just, you know, thought Bonnie was delightful, but never really very serious until probably, she went to Ann Arbor, University of Michigan, and he was there 2 years older, and I think that's when they really, really realized that they would be getting married. But, of course, they waited 4 years, so.
Oh, that's wonderful. While we're on your family, can you tell us your children's names and
our oldest,
what they're doing? And their
our oldest is Laura. She was born in 1960. She is married to a wonderful gentleman from Beirut, Lebanon. His name is Waleed Shema, and they have two daughters and one son. They have Alexandra, Isabella, and Anthony, named after Tony, which is delightful, especially since Tony really unofficially So now this makes it all official. Tony has often been asked, how did you get the name Tony when your name is Elliot? And he laughs and he said, no one really knows. My mother didn't know, but he suspects it was from a Mexican nursemaid that was taking care of him at the time. And there's so many people that call their children Tony. It's like our Bob or Dick. It's a very common Mexican name. And so we think this is how he got the name. And I've always loved the name. He's always been Tony to me and never Elliot.
That's wonderful.
So we do have Laura. Then we have Elliot, who we call Toby. He is 30 years old and married to JoAnne, J-O-N-A-N-N, slightly confusing with my name. And then Elizabeth is married to Seth Kelly. She is 28 and they live in La Jolla, California.
Okay.
And then we have David.
David
Anthony. He's the only child we have who we gave a middle, that has a middle name.
What does Toby do?
Toby is in money management with Stevens, the Stevens Group,
okay,
based in Little Rock, Arkansas.
Okay, and Toby went to Harvard, did he not?
Toby went to Stanford.
Oh, to Stanford.
And then he was a fighter pilot, and in a very accelerated program where you're only on active duty for 8 years, and then you are on reserve status for another four. So really, to fly jets, to be able to do it in that short, brief window was appealed to him greatly. And he flew until he got meningitis 3 years ago. What did you ask? Oh yes, that was after Stanford. And then he went on to Harvard Business School. Since he could no longer fly, he thought, well, he'd like to do something meaningful, and he took advantage of that time.
Great.
So he graduated from Harvard last June.
What was his degree in from Harvard?
His Harvard degree, he got his Master's of Business Administration.
Okay. But David is going to school.
David has graduated. David attended Harvard undergraduate school and just graduated a few months ago.
What did he get his degree in?
Harvard does not, undergraduate does not give you a business degree, so he majored in history.
Okay.
He loved it. But now he's in investment banking in New York.
Oh, fantastic. With what company?
He's with a small investment banking firm called BlackRock.
Okay. Laura and Liz went where to school?
They went to Denison in Ohio.
Okay. So did
never there at the same time. They're 5 years apart. So our we were on the Denison campus really for a period of 9 years.
Yes.
With one daughter or another.
God, yes. And Bonnie's child.
Bonnie's youngest son, Michael, went to Denison.
Okay.
As well.
Oh, that's great. And you have four, I can testify, four very fine children.
Thank you. Thank
very,
you.
Very good family.
Thank you. They love it here.
Oh,
yes. Oh, as you know.
Yes, and you're in the, you might as well tell us, you're right in the middle of house guests, aren't you, here? You just got rid of a group.
Uh-huh, and another coming, but that's
another
just the
coming.
Way it is. I love it. It was so unique this morning not to stand in line for the toaster. Just to be able to walk in the kitchen, no one's there.
It's always that way.
We love it. It's just comes alive.
That's fantastic.
And we're so grateful that our children love it as much as we do.
That's wonderful. That's wonderful. Going back to White Lake, Sylvan Beach, what are your first memories? If you had to go back to a memory.
I remember a happy memory, I don't know why it stands out in my mind, was our family would spend all afternoon on the beach, of course, when the weather permitted. And it was just very happy, happy times. And then we'd all go up to the house, and Mother dressed us all very much alike. There were always four dresses, four different daughters, and we all enjoyed that. We just felt we had a little club, a little sorority. But I think I was 5 years old when I remember that, how special it was, and we'd all just always lined up Jean, JoAnne, Bonnie, Carol in order of age and walked down to the Sylvan Beach Hotel with our parents for dinner so frequently.
Well,
and I remember walking down there.
And that's just the memory. And now,
uh-huh.
About what age was this?
I was five.
You were 5 years old,
uh-huh,
this time. What do you remember about the Sylvan Beach Hotel?
I remember it had what I thought was a huge dining room. And we'd walk in there and we'd have our table of actually five. And Carol was in a high chair. And just walking in and seeing all mother and father's friends and people we had just left on the beach, and it was just delightful. I don't know why that was such a happy memory, but they were happy times. I also remember the arcade going down there. It was where the Kitty Beach is, and I'm sure this is well documented with wonderful pictures, but as I remember it, there was a center area and then little stores on either side, perhaps a gift shop, and then there was an ice cream store, and I think the post office was in there too. And we'd go down there for ice cream cones, and also I think a boat docked there. It seems to me one of the
Carolina,
and we'd be down there meeting my father, and I can't tell you if that was on a Friday evening or Saturday morning, but we'd all go down there. And
about what age in your life did that stop?
I'm not sure, but all of a sudden it faded away. The post office was moved, and something, I think the arcade was torn down. I'd like to find out exactly what happened to that.
It was.
I remember a Coke machine.
Tell us
down there. It's just occurred to me. The Coke machine was in a remote place in the arcade, and I remember someone, one of our contemporaries, put their arm up where the Coke would slide out, and the arm got stuck. That's all I remember. I don't know who it was. I just remember watching some little boy, I think it could have been Skipper Chittenden, sticking his arm up, trying to reach a Coke. He didn't have any money, of course, and pulling and getting his arm caught. haven't seen much of Skipper since. Maybe it did him in.
He's the fellow with one arm walking around.
Oh, yeah. Skipper is Harriet Chittenden. Pearson Berman's nephew. And I remember Loker and Ann Chittenden going over to their home that the Schaefers now own.
Okay. Do you have any particular memories of that you'd like to share with us? Is there anything?
I just remember their family, lots of children.
Uh-huh. Very active. Mm-hmm. Helpful. Well, that's fascinating. What was, when you came in your, after you, 8, 10, 13, or whatever it may be, what was the first thing you did when you came to Sylvan Beach? Did you have something that...
We'd run to the beach.
We'd run to the beach.
We would just run to the beach. Of course, in that period of time, it took 7 hours, which is an eternity when you're young,
yeah.
5 and 6, in a car to get here. It was approximately 7 or 8 hours. And my father would drive one car, and my mother would drive another, loaded to the gills, of course, with summer equipment, because we stayed for 3 full months.
Wow, that's nice.
And when we got here, finally, we were released out of the car and just went our separate ways. We always felt very safe and secure here, and of course, we still do.
Yes. Did you ever spend the night on the road?
No. Don't remember. Not at all. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Did it. Along these same lines, do you associate any smells? Do you have any smells from your childhood of Sylvan Beach?
No, just the dead fish on the beach.
Just
quite a number of dead fish, always.
It's always.
Always little small white things, and there was a terrible odor. No, I don't remember any. We had Sylvan Beach days, perhaps, when I remember Annie Field's husband, Ben Field, would come up, and I remember before they had children, but Mr. Field would always dress up as the clown and jump off the diving board, and then we'd have watermelon scrambles was another one. They would grease the watermelon, and everyone in my age group would jump in and try to get the watermelon. Of course, you couldn't, and it's amazing to me that we didn't have lots of near drownings, because I remember I didn't like it very much as the years went on, because I'd always be kind of stepped upon.
Yeah.
And, yes.
Crawling,
uh-huh,
and grabbing,
uh-huh,
and probably hitting and everything.
And else. Then something else we'd do, there was another water activity. Everyone would jump in the water with clothes on to see who could get, and then the person that won was the person that got their clothes off first. You'd get something off and you'd throw it on the dock, and all the parents were watching. And then there was the whole arcade dock was decorated with balloons. There was just a little line of balloons going all the way out. And then Mr. Field would always be the clown and jump off the diving board in his clown makeup. I hope I'm not making this up. I hope it happened.
I'm sure
I'm remembering these things whether they did or not.
Sylvan Beach Days you mentioned. Can you explain to us about Sylvan?
I cannot. I just remember in those days there was always a lifeguard down there who was a certified swimming instructor. And we would take very serious swimming lessons always. And this was kind of the cumulation to the summer's swimming lessons activities.
Like
I think, yes. If I had known we were going to discuss this, or even if I knew I was going to remember it, I would have asked questions about it before we had this discussion.
Well,
but
that's okay.
I think that's what it was. Lots of fun.
Well,
oh, and we have.
Think of something, and we finish the tape. You can always call me. We can
crank it up again.
Good. We'll bring it up again too. That's great.
And I remember the war. I remember when the war was over.
Oh, great. Tell us about.
We felt immune from the war once we were here in Chicago. Although we lived outside of Chicago, we would have blackout shades, which were oilcloth, and. Every night when it got dark, my parents would go around and put oilcloth or pull them down on all the windows so our house would be blacked out. And this was a routine, and of course you can imagine it was disturbing to a 7-year-old as I was at the time. And we didn't do that up here. We came up here and we felt, and I'm sure this was a very false sense of security. We felt we were safe here, and so there was no putting any blackout shades on the windows at all.
Because who would want to bomb the woods?
Who'd want to bomb Muskegon, Michigan? I do remember when the war was over, there was so much commotion. My mother, she won't like to hear this, but she was changing out of her bathing suit and before she got dressed for the evening, and she was in her full-length slip, and all of a sudden they got the news. The war was over, and before she got the news, there was horns honking, cars were blaring their horns, and there was so much noise up and down Murray Road. And my father came in and said, "The war is over. They've declared peace." And my mother went running out on her slip, and I I remember that. But that was a wonderful, happy memory for us.
What did you do when the war was over that day?
Well, I think Mother went in and put a dress on, and then other than that, I don't know, but everyone was so happy, so we all were happy.
Yes. Must have been a wonderful.
And we would say our prayers, of course, for years before, during the war. God bless all the sailors, all the soldiers, all the Marines, and all the waxes and the waves. And anyone we knew that was in military service, and with 4 children, there was a lot of God blessing of the troops that went on for a long time at our bedtime hour. And all of a sudden, we didn't say that anymore. And I remember thinking, it's over.
Yes. Well, do you remember rationing during the
Yes,
war?
Definitely.
Did that affect your trips to and fro?
No, I remember coupon books, and Mother would talk about, well, if we have enough coupons, we'll buy some sugar and we can make fudge tonight. So she'd count her coupons and then we'd go buy sugar. But I don't remember never having had rationing. Was it rationing or rationing?
Rationing.
I don't remember not having it, Joe. So it was just part of the way we operated. If we had enough, I think obviously, my parents would save up the gas coupons for this trip. That was never a consideration, but I just remember the sugar.
The sugar was the
And I that was just always the way it was.
What business was your father
in? My father was in real estate.
Real estate.
With Ross and Brown, a company in Chicago. At the offices were right behind the Palmolive building, which at that point in time was the tallest building in Chicago, and now it's just dwarfed. But actually, his offices were in the Palmolive building, which is right behind the Drake Hotel.
On to a different topic. During your years here, who were some of the outstanding sailors and tennis players that you've watched, male and female?
Mrs. Terryberry, Monty Terryberry, and her husband were always on the tennis court. And it was wonderful to see them. My mother was not a tennis player, but they were my mother's contemporaries. So Mother was on the golf course, and I remember Mrs. Burroughs, Mary Helen Burroughs, playing tennis all the time as well. Our generation really didn't play tennis. Bonnie McCall played tennis, Jim McCall played tennis. Bonnie McCall took up the game because Jim McCall played tennis. So she from the time she was 8 and 9 and 10 years old, she was playing tennis, I think, because Jim McCall did.
Jim played tennis.
I didn't take it up until 20 years ago. When I was 10, right? I remember the Sailors, Tom Getz, Bruce Stewart, Dwayne Pearson, Alvin Youngquist, Al Youngquist we call them. Wonderful group. Joe Partridge, Doug's younger brother. And they were just that much older than I was. And they were such nice guys. Wonderful. Wonderful teenagers, but they were the Sailors that
they
I knew.
Were the Sailors.
And when I took sailing school, Al Youngquist was my instructor, Bruce Stewart. But it was a wonderful link to that generation of boys,
yes.
The sailing school and the yacht club activities.
Miss, can you tell us something about the junior yacht club at that time? Did you join?
Oh, yes. We all were very, very big. Big in the junior yacht club. Every Thursday night, we would have, after dinner, we would go to junior yacht club meetings, and they'd have social functions, and it was wonderful.
Can you give me the approximate years that you were in the junior yacht club? That would be from ages 12.
I think you have to be exactly 12, so that would be 49, 50, until probably 1954.
Okay, do you remember what the dues were at that time?
No! I'd forgotten we even paid dues.
Yes. Do you remember any of the junior Commodores you had?
Buster Diamond. Everyone, he's legendary.
Yes.
Dave Van Enenum. The Van Enenum family was up here for probably only about 10 years. They had a house down by the Denisons and the Rices. Above the Hodsons, actually, north, and that house unfortunately had to be abandoned. It was condemned because of the sand dune was eroding underneath it, so they stopped coming, and it was a great loss to the community because they had John Van Enenum, who was Bruce Stewart, Doug Partridge's age, and then Dave Van Enenum, who was a year older than I, and then his sister Beeb, Isla, who was a year younger than I, and they were wonderful, wonderful people and great friends. Dave was a Commodore. Also, he was King. Is it King of the
King.
Junior
he
Yacht Club?
King.
The year I was Queen. So Tony must not have been around much that summer because I remember Dave Van Enenum and I saw quite a bit of each other. That was my senior year in high school because the following year I went off to University of Colorado, and Dave and I had an understanding that we'd communicate and write. And Tony happened to be in Colorado, so I just never really saw Dave again.
Yeah. can you name some more of the King and Queens?
JoAnne Lida,
okay.
Buster Diamond, I think they were King and Queen at one point in time. I really can't.
Okay. Well,
other than that.
That's kind of a tough one, for sure. Who were some of the most notable characters in your lifetime?
Up here?
Yes.
When I was a little older old enough to leave, you know, to do junior yacht clubs, or actually even before that, like probably 9 and 10 and 11, Tom Panyard and Buster Diamond. Legendary. Oh, my goodness. Buster did everything so much sooner than anyone else was allowed to, or even before he legally should. But he was driving a car at 12 and 13, and not only forwards, but he would put the car in reverse down at the tennis court and back up the whole hill. We just thought that was just a typical Buster, but he was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
We were never allowed to get in a car with Buster. And as you know, he died in a car.
Mm-hmm. But he was quite a nice man. Too,
nice
Buster.
Person. And Tom Panyard was as short as Buster was tall.
Yeah.
And they were...
Tommy was a nice fellow.
So much fun, yes.
Yeah, very nice.
Yes.
Very nice.
But they were our characters. They were the characters. And then in our particular circle of friends, Ben Goodspeed, not from Sylvan Beach, but he was down here often, and actually he is the godfather of our youngest child, David. And Ben unfortunately died 10 years ago now of a heart attack at age 44. And then Dick Marvel would come from near Whitehall. I can't think of the area.
On Bluff Road.
Dick Marvel would join us as soon. We knew him through the Junior Yacht Club, but as soon as he got his driver's license, he was here every evening for parties, and we had a wonderful, innocent, lovely time. Lots of fun and games and songs.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's died out.
It has. It has. Buster would bring beer down, but really, no one really was interested in it. Buster was, and Tom.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that. So your group didn't drink very much?
No.
Until you were probably into college, and then it was probably a lot more, which is the same with our group. We didn't drink until college, once a summer or something, or twice.
It was never why we went to the beach.
No. Do you have any fish stories that you could relate
fish
to?
Fish stories?
Yeah, just fishing or anything?
I never liked fishing.
Oh, okay.
I know.
Okay.
I'm not a good one to ask about fishing. Nope.
What are some of the outstanding jinxes that you remember and jinx skits?
Oh, so much fun.
And the people who ran them?
I really remember who ran them, which is unfortunate. I suppose if I thought about it long, I'd be able to come up with some names, but I remember one number I particularly loved was a square dance, and there were bales of hay up on the stage, and everyone who was in the jinx was in every number as in the background on the bales of hay. And our particular number, Tom Panyard, Buster Diamond, JoAnne Lotta, and myself, and Beeb, and Margot Reitz, we did a little square dance, and Rosemary Spickelmeyer was the caller. And in the background of that picture, I think it's so clear in my mind because I recently saw a photograph, Dodd and Hartman, Bud Crampton, who is a Goodspeed cousin, Margot Hodson Tukey, just everyone and Lucy and Barb and Betty Post were in the background of that picture. So all the generations, I should not say generations, but all the different age groups were represented on the stage. Oh, and in the same photograph, Bonnie and Carol, and I don't think they must be 5 and 7 years old. So I was 9 and when that particular number took place.
What other memories do you have of Jinx's?
I remember elaborate costumes, and it seemed to me our mothers would be so busy making real costumes. But then we were all up here for months and months, so you could spend your time that way. Now it's just such a brief fleeting time in everyone's life when you come up and you don't do the elaborate costumes.
Are there any other jinx memories you have?
I remember Kathy Redman and Dick Dennison. Of course, later we all know that they got married, and Judy Van de Vender did a wonderful number. I can't remember what it means, so that's a silly answer to your question.
No, that's okay.
I remember the Mississippi Mud number. If I thought about it, I probably could remember way back, but nothing is coming to mind.
Okay. Were you ever in any of Doug Schmidt's jinxes?
Yes.
Did you do the steampunk number?
Sounds familiar. I don't think I did that number.
Okay, with the fire extinguishers beneath the floor.
I think that was Bonnie. I was just that much older where I wasn't in that number. I think I probably was. I did the jinx 2 years in a row with Carl Jacob.
Oh, wow.
Dr. Jacob.
What did you do?
I don't even remember our numbers. Carl had all the plans, and I just was his assistant, and I helped with choreography, and just what the helper does. I don't remember one title. I'm embarrassed about that. I hope you talk to Carl. I'm sure he certainly will remember what he did, but we did that for 2 years in a row.
Wow. That's fascinating. Well,
as you look at things, during your lifetime, what social changes have you noticed here at Sylvan Beach and White Lake? Have you noticed anything? For instance, are there more parties? Is there more drinking? Are there more cocktail parties? Are they more official?
Well, I think the beautiful thing about this area and our Sylvan Beach community is there have not been too many changes. I love it. It's the one place you can go and it looks the same, and the faces, there's so many faces you've known all your life. It has not changed from my perspective. Unfortunately, I think it has changed for the younger group. It can be alarming sometimes.
Yes.
But I'm really removed from that at this point in my life with my children, and my grandchildren are too young. So I don't really think it has changed.
Okay.
Someone else would disagree, but I feel that's the beauty of it all.
Okay. Can you describe for me, just put yourself back into your teenage years or your favorite years or whatever years you wish to choose. What did you do on your average day and night? Think of just, whether it's a hodgepodge of everything, but just...
Well, of course, that varied depending on one's age. It was blissfully happy and naive and lovely, and I think it still is up here.
Carefree, yeah.
I think it's wonderful that a place still exists. Well, we would get up in the morning. When we were younger, it was slightly more scheduled because we had the activities director, and I probably from the time I was 5, I was down taking swimming lessons, diving lessons, and that continued for a number of years. And as now, your morning activities are on the White Lake dock area, and your afternoon is on the larger beach with lunch in between. And I don't think that's changed at all. And it's we had an activities director that really for years, probably until I was 13, that would organize everything. And there was a great structure to the summer as far as the children went. Only 2 weeks were jinx practice. The other month would be swimming lessons, diving lessons, and then later, of course, as I got older, sailing lessons. The activities director would have an arts and craft day once or twice a week, so we'd be down making those little bracelets with the plastic, different designs.
Do you remember who that was?
I don't remember any of them at all. They were not Sylvan Beach residents. I think they were brought in. Oh, it was delightful people.
Delightful. Did they live in the WAB Club in those quarters?
That's it. Okay. You brought it up. The Mahoneys. There was, I could picture them as if it's today, but I don't remember their first names. They were a couple. They had a daughter who was approximately my age, and I think they lived in the Wabanawa Club for years, didn't they?
Yeah, I think you're right.
I'm sure you know. That's right. And they did all that. And when they weren't there, then I remember there were others. But they were seemingly, from my vantage point, being so young, they were professionals. And another activity we do once a summer was take a hike to Duck Lake. And this is when you could walk on the sand all the way. And we would meet at our Wabanawa Club, and everyone had their little brown bag with our hard-boiled egg and sandwich and drinks, and we would just carry it in a paper bag as we hiked all the way down to Duck Lake, and it took a long time. I remember thinking it was a lot of fun the first half and dreading the idea, oh my goodness, and how do we ever get home? But then we'd get there, and there was a wonderful sand dune that we'd climb up and roll down, and this was something we did for years and years on end.
You just played yourself until you died.
Yes, and I think that the Duck Lake hike probably was the end to all the activities of the summer. That seemed to wrap it all up. But the jinx was just a center part of our summer. There was a lot more before and a lot more afterwards.
Okay, during these years, like your teenage years, did you have a curfew?
Oh yes, we all had to be in, definitely.
What time was that?
Well, I remember, it didn't ever get dark until around 10 o'clock, but we all had to be in by dark. That was it. And then as we got a little older, I remember Mrs. Lida, JoAnne Lida's mother, Mrs. Van Nienenum, Mrs. Burroughs, Mrs. Reitz, and my mother, I heard rumor that our mothers had started a little organization called the Maytags. Now that stood for Mothers Association for Young Teenage Girls. And they made up our rules. They were the final word, so that there was no negotiating because all of them had the same set of rules. We were not to go in cars. We were not to do this. We were to be in before it got dark. And I think eventually when we were 13, 14, we could stay out maybe till 11. I remember Jean and I were always a team, and Mother bent the rules a little bit to let me go with Jean. So, but oh yes, there was a tight rein, which I think was wonderful. Yeah. We all knew where we stood at all times.
That's a good idea too, all the mothers getting together like that. Yes. Yeah. Solves a lot of problems that could come up.
Uh-huh.
Let's see here. One more.
I'm so glad.
I got lots more here.
So glad you remembered the people that lived in the Wabanango Club.
Do you remember the old ski ramp that you used to
use? Oh, my goodness, yes. Outside the Diamonds?
Yeah.
Margaret and Buster Diamond. Oh, well, I didn't even water ski, much less take a ski jump. The first time I water skied was behind my friend Marva Lanouette's big brother's boat, Bill Lanouette. And he was nice enough to take me water skiing. I was 13.
Still
and
very
I
nice.
Almost, yes. And he had a wooden Chris Craft, and I almost drowned. I mean, I didn't think I'd ever get up. I never did get up. And they had to haul me into the boat after patiently letting me try for probably a half an hour. The ramp, we'd watch Buster and Margaret take it. But it was thrilling. And I remember Margaret missed once, and she skidded all the way up, and she was very bad shape.
Yeah.
She was totally scraped and full of splinters.
She ran right into the...
Well, she went up it and fell as she was going up, so she just went, I don't really know the ending, but...
banged up.
Mm-hmm. No, I was terrified of it.
Yeah. How long was that there? Do you remember when it wasn't there?
I remember when it wasn't there.
Yeah, okay.
It was all of a sudden someone's family put the water skiing jump up. It was not an association.
Okay.
I think it was the Diamonds jump.
Yeah.
And it was there for several years, and then it wasn't there.
Now was this actually a ramp?
Yes.
Okay, it was a ramp. Mm-hmm. Because when I was a kid, there was just four poles and a dock section.
Oh, no. This was a real white ramp, and it had maroon sides.
And they would be approximately what years? I mean, just 40, 50, what?
Mm-hmm.
Just 40, 50 to 55, 57?
I think before then.
Okay.
I think
an actual ramp, that's fascinating.
An actual ramp. They'd go up, and then the Diamonds got quite good at it. They'd go up, and then as they got better and better, you know, they'd do splits in the air and then come together, and they were very good. And there were lots of accidents on that ramp.
Oh, I imagine there probably was.
Yes, and I remember beyond the ramp was the ice house, the arcade. It wasn't the arcade, but wasn't it an ice house, a room? And they
Sellers Place is one ice house.
No, this was way out in the lake.
Okay.
It was between the Wob Club and Lakeside.
Oh, the Ark?
The Ark.
The Ark, yeah.
I remember the Ark.
Oh, yeah, I remember that.
I remember water skiing. It was always kind of in our way.
Yeah, sailing, too, was always.
That's true.
Around the buoy there. Mm-hmm. You had to go around mm-hmm. the Ark many times.
One thing, back to our activities director, we would have probably one or two nights a week. There would be, I think one night a week, some beach activity in the evenings. And we'd have Capture the Flag games. We would have stories on the beach. And the old pump house, which is down in front of the Schmitz. There were two pump houses that, as I remember, they were rather frightening.
Is that where that cement thing is now?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Good.
And there were actual windows in these pump houses, but the sand kept burying the windows. So some years you'd come up and you'd just kind of see a roof, and some years you really could actually see the full window. And these were abandoned at that point, but the structures remained. And they were just weren't pleasant looking. They kind of scared us, and we'd peek in the windows, and everything was rusty and old looking. But we'd have a lot of fun playing hide and go seek around that. It gave us a structure from which we could hide. And another memory was that John Devine Sr. And I just remember when I was a child, every Sunday night at his home, which is the one that the Edsons bought in 1949, after John Devine died. I don't know when John Devine died or how long the... I think the Edsons rented the cottage perhaps a few years before they bought it. But as a child, I remember on Sunday evenings, it was story hour at Mr. Navine's, and we would go down to his house. I was always with Jean. And we'd go down to his house, and he'd have bowls of popcorn. And he would sit in the living room at that wonderful, I want to say mahogany, but it was a beam that supported the second story. It was a load-bearing structure, but it also had a chair in it. And he'd sit there. We thought it was his little throne. It was so appropriate for him to be there. And we'd sit there all around the floor. He'd sit there and he'd tell us stories. And I don't know how many years that went on, but it was a great highlight.
And that was, now he wasn't very deeply involved in the Sylvan Beach Church, wasn't he? I don't know. Okay, I've heard that he found, basically got the church.
I don't know, but his son, John and Grace Navine, would eventually, I think, they didn't live with him, they had their own cottage, which is still the Navine cottage. And they had their four children. Tim Navine was a contemporary of ours, and John. So John and Tim, John passed away when he was 10 years old
of
a stomach cancer. And it was the first time, because he was my age and Tim was 12, he was Jean's age, but little John was there always, and it was just such a surprise and to hear that he had died. Because
was it a long-term illness?
I don't remember his being ill, so I think it happened over a winter period of time. And then all of a sudden he wasn't up here anymore, and because he had died. And it was my first experience with losing someone my age. But it was his grandfather that would have the story hour.
You mentioned Tim Navine. He was quite a character.
Wonderful.
Very kind man still.
And he was so much more mature than we were.
He used to have that chair that sat out on the bluff where he'd go out and sit on that pedestal that used to be down there in that chair.
A pulley?
No, it was like a pedestal with a wooden chair on it right on the bluff.
I don't. That escapes me.
That's just something I can remember.
Maybe Gene would remember that, but I don't remember that. But Tim was always so fine. He was a fine person.
Yeah, he is. In your lifetime, what was the worst storm you can remember here? Did you have any?
When I was a child, no one had phones. Then we got party lines, and then we never could get the phone.
Your phone number?
No. But I remember we finally got a phone, but we didn't really need to have it. We never could use it because someone was always talking on the phone. Our neighbor, we really didn't know who was on our party line, but I think probably good 6 families were all sharing lines. But in a storm, of course, the phone would stop working for quite a period of time. The lights would always go out, and I remember candles always. To this day, I keep a lot of candles just in case the lights don't go back on, but electricity has come a long way.
Yeah.
So we haven't had to have those candlelight evenings, but things simply would stop working in big storms, and there we'd have a lot of big storms every year.
Do you remember any certain storm, particular storm?
No, a real good storm, a measure of a good storm would be when Jane Pelton's porch screens would be all over the yard the next day. And it still is a good measure of a good storm. Except now we're picking them up.
You're picking
them. Now that we have the cottage.
That's right. To the lake and that. During your lifetime, do you remember the lake being higher or lower? Can you tell
me? My earliest memory was of the beach going out forever. In fact, it's the early pictures of the beach at that time. There were not many dunes, It was just long, long expanse of sand. And I remember it that way for most of my childhood. And then there was talk about the waters getting higher, and everyone was a little concerned. People started moving cottages back. And long before that, one of my early memories was walking all the way down from our McFadden cottage past John Naveen, Story Hour gentleman, to the Bartlett's house, to the Staten's house, and this was all on the path. And of course now you know it ends almost at Dallas Dort's. You cannot walk in front of anything beyond his house. But as a child, we'd go to Mrs. Bartlett's house, who was Mim Butterfield Barr's mother's home, which was the Buckinghams.
Okay.
And Mrs. Bartlett lived there, and she was a friend of my grandmother's. So my grandmother would take us on walks, and we'd just walk straight down the path to the Buckinghams, which is, you know, you can't do that at all. And even beyond that, I think we went to Dacey's. We could walk in front of Dacey's.
And it ended. It never returned.
It's waxed and waned a lot, but you know.
Was there ever a period where there was about the same amount of beach?
No, there was. It was never as beachy.
Okay, so it's waxed and waned.
Yeah, as far as the bank, but I mean, you know, that was seemed quite abrupt when that happened.
Yeah. Remember approximately what year that would be?
No. Okay. Nope. In the '50s.
In the '50s, which would be the St. Lawrence would have been opened in 1957.
But there was great discussions. You know, anytime you were with the another generation, my parents' generation, we were slightly removed financially from all this discussion and concern, because we were just blissfully happy children. But they talk about the water rising and what can they do, and so it's been never returned to the way it used to be, of course.
Is the lake cleaner or dirtier?
Oh, I remember some days we couldn't have our swimming lessons because it was just pea green down at the dock.
At White Lakeside.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Seems to me it's a lot cleaner.
A lot cleaner. They were probably still dumping into the lake.
Of course, the disturbing thing now is the clutter and the cigarettes and the what people just leave on the beach and without cleaning up at all. That's so much worse. That was never a problem when we were growing up. It is a terrible problem now.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But the water, I think, is a lot cleaner.
Okay, that's good news.
Well, maybe I'm remembering it wrongly, but there were a lot of times we couldn't take our swimming lessons.
And that would have been 40s, 50s, right?
And when I actually was a lifeguard, I'll give you the exact year in a few minutes, but some of my little charges, my little guys, were Jake and Pete Ehlers, Robbie Crow, Teddy Edson, Jeff Butterfield, and all these guys, of course, now are 45.
Yeah, 46.
So they were part of the group, and I had little games. I'd organize games in the morning. Even though the activity director was no longer the lifeguard, it was still something I'd do, and there were many mornings when I'd have to say no lifeguard because of the, what did we call it, the green film,
the slime, algae and all that.
I'd have to close the beach.
Now, how many years did you lifeguard?
I did that for 2 summers.
For 2 summers.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember what you were paid?
No. And it really didn't seem to matter, but it was one of the few paying jobs I've ever had.
Uh-huh.
And I was delighted with the money I got. I don't remember what it was.
Do you remember any moonlight sails?
We did that.
Who did you used to go with, or was there any particular?
I'm not sure. I think it was the older group that would do that. I want to say Dodden, Hartman, Applegate, and Lucy Children Peterson. They did it a lot more than our group, and I remember being a little concerned when we'd do it. You really couldn't see where you were going. It sounded like a wonderful idea in the daylight, and then the evening would come and it would be cold out there, and it was not my favorite thing, but I do remember it. And then, of course, Buster Diamond would ski sometimes at night.
I remember Buster. He was a wonderful man. Wild.
Well, he had a lot of fun.
Yeah, he was a very fun guy and a very nice man, too. Do you remember any particular sailboat races you had? Any experiences that were...
No, I remember when Kelly and Charlene Sellers first came to Sylvan Beach. They had a marvelous built boat, Y-Flyer, built for their daughter Nan, and I crewed on Nan's boat, and it was a thrill to crew for her because she won every race. So we were winning every race. That was a lot of fun. Bebe Van Eenen and I crewed every Saturday. And Nancy Yeoman Sterrett had a boat called the Mad Plaid, and it was a Y-Flyer, and it
Y-5,
painted
Y-5.
Y-5.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I remember the Mad
painted
Plaid.
In squares.
Yes.
Different colors.
The tires on the front.
Yes, yes. And then I got a Y-Flyer, and that was a lot of fun, but I came in last. I wasn't proud. I always, someone has to lose, and I think I lost every single race, and Nan won every single race, and we had quite a large fleet, too.
Do you remember the number of your Y-Flyer?
One, Y-1.
Was it the actual Y-1?
Mm-hmm. And it was, the name of the boat was One for All. And our Chris Craft was named All for One.
Oh, that's great.
So when they followed the races, of course, they were All for Number One. And and the Y-Flyer, my boat, was All, One for All, meaning all my sisters. But they really didn't care to sail very much. So I was the captain, skipper, and I'd get lots of people to crew for me. But no one really wanted to crew for me because I always came in last. And it was much more fun to crew for Nan.
But you had fun doing it.
Oh, I had a wonderful time. I just love being out there.
Oh, that's exciting. Do you remember Joe Sedoni?
Oh, yes.
Can you tell us something about
yes.
him? Do you have any particular memory?
Joe and Art Sedoni were contemporaries of my mother's, and I believe actually they were probably a bit younger than mother, who at this point is 80.
Which, by the way, I'm going to get her on tape too.
Oh, good,
yeah.
Good. Oh,
just tell her,
she can correct my early memories. I remember as a child going over to visit with the senior, Mr. Sedoni, and I was fascinated. I remember he talked to us for a couple of hours, and we asked questions. He gave us a tour of the Pines, which he named his home. He told us some of his marvelous stories, and it was a fascinating experience. And I only met him that one time. But his boys, Art and Joe, were, after Mr. Sedoni died, they married late in life. I think, were they not in their 50s? Age 50
yeah.
when they got married,
yeah,
or late 40s, and then had children quite late in life. But they always had twinkles in their eye. They were delightful.
Well, yeah.
And of course, my mother, Ruth Guggins Roosevelt, was a friend of theirs. And I have a marvelous picture of Ruth sailing with Elliot Roosevelt, her husband, and Joe Sedoni on an A.
Nemesis.
Is that it? The Nemesis? It's a marvelous picture of all three of them.
Do you have any memories of Mrs. Roosevelt? Any particular memories?
Oh, Eleanor Roosevelt?
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Can you
oh,
tell
yes.
us about her, just
My regret is I didn't really appreciate being in her company and her presence as much as I should have.
Yes.
She was Tony's grandmother.
Right.
But before that, I have to tell you something that
yes.
that I hear from my mother, and it's amusing. When the Edson family started coming back up, Tony was probably 12 years old when they bought that house, or started renting the Naveen Cottage.
Okay.
And everyone was saying, well, Ruth Roosevelt is now married to a Harry Edson. And I would just listen to the adults talk, and they said, can you believe that she brought Elliot Roosevelt up here a couple of years, and they'd have to bring their Secret Service men to protect them, and it caused quite a commotion, and Elliot Roosevelt was scandalous. He was the first gentleman up here who didn't wear a top to his bathing suit. And he also had shoes with tassels on them. And I just remember those two examples of how avant-garde and fast he was. But anyway, little Ruthie Googans divorced him and married nice Harry Edson was the story. And then they came up and there was Tony and Chandler. Wonderful, wonderful kids that we all enjoyed. But that was my first memory of even hearing the Roosevelt name outside of President Roosevelt.
Yes. Can you tell us something about Tony's mother? Tony's grandmother? Any experiences that you had with her?
Tony's grandmother.
Tony's mother.
Oh, Tony's mother. Well, it's hard to separate because she was such a... She was just...
Both.
Yeah. All right, my mother-in-law.
Yeah.
All right, but you want to probably... You mentioned Eleanor?
Eleanor, yes, first.
I'm trying to remember the first time I ever met her. I don't know when that was. She was a wonderful grandmother. And I will go down on record as saying she was a wonderful grandmother, a much better grandmother than a mother, because she had more confidence in that role. And I think her mothering pretty much was taken over by her mother-in-law when she was a young mother. So she really didn't do that very well. She was a wonderful grandmother, and she really only has had 12 of her own grandchildren. There were others came along that were adopted or adopted the Roosevelt name, even though they were... But she actually really only had, I think, 12 official grandchildren, and of which Chandler, Tony, and Tony's younger brother, David, were three. But she'd take them on her trips, official trips to Europe and Mexico, and traveled with them, and she shopped for them, and she always remembered their birthdays and sent them gifts that she had personally selected, and she'd write wonderful letters to them. And once Tony and I were married, she'd write lovely letters, warm letters to me in her own hand. A lot were typed, but she was very, very vitally interested in her grandchildren. And also her great-grandchildren. She lived to have quite a number of those until her death in 1963. We had Laura, and Laura was 2 1/2 when, at the time of Eleanor Roosevelt's death. And she sent Laura, she was as conscientious a great-grandmother as she was a grandmother. She always made sweeps through towns just to visit her children and would take speaking engagements. When I say children, I mean her grandchildren. And she would work her speaking engagements around where her grandchildren were, so she could stay with them, spend the night with them, and it was a very natural presence. It was not at all intimidating. She was just such a warm person.
She was as compassionate as warm.
That I didn't really recognize her place in history. She certainly recognized her place in history, because the gifts we would receive for Laura and the books she would give Laura and her grandchildren would always say to Laura Roosevelt from her great-grandmother, Eleanor Roosevelt, December 1961.
Dating them and signing.
Dating them, and we would receive, she gave Laura a silver cup with that same engraving, to Laura Roosevelt from her great-grandmother, Eleanor Roosevelt, on the date of Laura's birth, June 14th, 1960. So she had a great sense of her place, much more so than I did. And she also, though, with these serious gifts, she would also send something fun, a little animal for the child or a little busy box or something. So she was very, very unique that she could do everything so well. It was a great privilege. It's a wonderful heritage.
Oh, yes.
It's a wonderful heritage for our children and grandchildren.
She certainly had a very important part in helping this country through some very hard times.
Certainly was. And, way ahead of her time.
Yes.
Way ahead of her time.
Yeah, and certainly a great loss to the country and the world.
Oh, but she set a wonderful example for women everywhere.
Yes, she did. She's very great. Mrs. Edson, do you remember do you have any particular memories?
Ruth Googans?
Yes.
Oh, just that she was adorable. she was lovely.
Just very great.
And died very prematurely up here. June 16th, 1974, she died very suddenly, but she died at a place she loved, and I know her spirit is still here. because she was so happy here.
Did you ever see her spirit there in the valley?
That's a very long involved story, and I think I'll save that for another time.
Okay. Harry Edson was quite a man in his own rights. Do you remember anything?
Oh, yes. Harry still is alive, and not as well as we wish, down in Austin, Texas. When Ruth died in 1974, Harry had the ability to simply block out those 30 years he had with her. He didn't block them out in that sense, but he did not really want to come back up. I think she was such a part of this place, and they were so happy up here together that it was something he couldn't do alone. And so it was easier for Harry just to shut the door on those wonderful, wonderful years up here. And he really never has come back.
No, that next summer was the only
time. Mm-hmm. But he was a very wonderful man, and he loved gadgets, and he was he had a wonderful sense of humor, and he made Ruth so happy.
Yes. Oh, he adored her.
He did.
He adored her.
He did.
I remember after Ruth had her problems with her heart, mm-hmm. Harry was always right there, mm-hmm. just serving her a drink or whatever it was needed.
They were just devoted to each other.
Yeah. A very great loss mm-hmm. with both of them not
exactly
being here. Outside of your family, what was the biggest wedding you could remember up here? Most exciting, biggest, or one that just
I remember Nancy Vandevender when she married Hugh Lilly. Now, why do I remember that? I don't even know the year, but that was the first wedding to my knowledge that was up here, and I was a young... Oh, I wish she were here to tell me how many years ago that was. I remember several of us went up to what is the Ehlers Garage. I guess it was the Berger Garage at the time.
Yeah.
And so we had a wonderful view of the wedding, and we were very quiet little faces at the window watching this wedding. But that was the first wedding
that
I remember. And then I remember Carol Ehlers. That's a coincidence. Carol Ehlers' wedding to Dave Stanwish was up here, and actually the wedding was in front of the Ehler cottage, but the reception was in the wedding reception yard of the McFadden property between the McFaddens and the Peltons.
Excuse me. Okay, another name with the Sidoni name would be Jack DeFraga. Do you remember
Jack DeFraga? Yes.
Can you tell us about him?
No, I can't tell you a thing about him. I just remember the name. And he was always at the yacht club.
Okay.
And he was a real sailor. He epitomized, he just had that reputation of being a real sailor.
Great sailor.
Uh-huh.
And I guess he could draw quite well, too.
Yes, in fact, we have a map that he drew.
Yes.
Here.
Several of those are around.
And actually, it just came with this cottage, and I was not aware of. One day I looked at it very closely after taking it for granted on the walls, and I looked at the signature, and it was DeFraga. I went, for heaven's sakes, didn't know he did that.
Yeah, he did a lot of the, those. We have one from Clarence, had one died, but there's a lot of them around. Not a lot, but there's probably 18 or so of those maps around.
I remember men like my father's golfing friends, Bob Baird, Homer Hartz,
Do you remember any smells about your father?
Huffaker, Mr. Huffaker, Duttenhofer, there was a Duttenhofer, that name may ring a bell, but those were all cronies of my father's who loved golf and spent a lot of time up at the club. Or the course.
You mentioned the Second World War. The Korean War came soon after. Do you have any memories of that?
My memory of that was Joe Partridge. He was just that much older than I, and I thought Joe was wonderful. And he stood out in my mind because I was at the yacht club a lot, as we all were on Saturdays, and he'd always ask how I was, how are you? And he'd speak to the kids 6-10 years younger than he, and made everyone feel very, very special. Joe just had that quality, and I remember him for that. And my memory of the Korean War was that Joe went to the Korean War, and I was concerned about that because he had always been so nice to me. And he came back from the Korean War safe and sound, and I remember hearing a story that he was so happy and grateful to arrive safely back in California on United States soil after serving his country, and within half an hour he realized his wallet had been picked from his back pocket in the United States. And I almost cried. Yeah. I thought,
a lot of thanks.
Yes, poor Joe. How ironic.
Yeah, to go through all of that, and then to come back and have that happen.
It was horrible. So really, as far as, well, I remember a lot about the Korean War, of course, but that was one of my nice, it's a nice memory just because it's...
How did you feel about that war?
It was threatening to all of us. It was very frightening. It was really, of course, we had World War II, and then we had Korea shortly thereafter, and... Actually, my Tony Roosevelt, Tony and Chandler, were on a trip to Norway with their grandmother, Eleanor Roosevelt, and were going to be gone for 3 months. It was a business trip. They were going to see the Crown Prince. They actually stayed at the castle in Norway of Olaf, perhaps it was Crown Prince Olaf. And he had daughters, Tony and Chandler's ages. So, they had a wonderful time there, and this trip was to go on for several months. I might be exaggerating, but within a month they had to return because of the Korea War broke out. So the war obviously broke out during the summer, and Tony and Chandler's trip was cut short, and they all came back to the United States.
Did you think that war was going to last long? What were your feelings about it?
Well, Joe, we didn't have much communication. You know, you listened to radio, and there weren't correspondents. Of course, now it's a television war. We know hour to hour what's happening, and as in the Persian Gulf War, it's just incredible how that situation has changed. These earth-shaking events we watch on television.
Yes, second to second, even.
Russian Revolution. The wars, you know, it was remote. We felt, as a result, much further removed.
Didn't have.
And then, of course, Vietnam. We were old enough. That went on for a long time, and we read about that in the newspapers. And of course, there was a little bit of that on starting to be covered in television. And that became, the more you heard, the more you saw, the more disturbing it all became. And world is too small for wars, especially having a son-in-law from the Middle East. You know, that Persian Gulf War just was shameful.
Does your son-in-law go back to
all the time? Every summer he goes to visit his mother, who lives in the same home he was raised in. And a year ago he took our 4-year-old granddaughter to Beirut, and this year, just last June, he took both our granddaughters, who at the time were 5 1/2 and 2 3/4, took them all the way around the world to Beirut, and they loved it. Alex has wonderful memories of playing on the seashore and being with her grandmother, sleeping in the bed her father slept in when he was a child. So for our grandchildren, the world is small.
Yeah, yes it is.
Because they have relatives there.
Yeah. What do you think about the world today? You mentioned it's smaller. Is it good, bad? Do you have hope? Are things getting better? Are things getting worse?
I feel we are a very spoiled, indulged society. We are going to have to sacrifice so much to get this United States back on track, and yet we all talk about it. When it comes actually down to doing it, no one really knows what to do. I think we're pretty much leaderless. It's not attractive to be a president anymore. It's a thankless job. I think we're in, unfortunately, a very, very sad state of affairs. And I think, tragically, something awful is going to happen to get us on track again.
Yeah,
I hate to think of a plague or a depression, but I think it's going...
Or war.
Oh, the world is too small for war. The nuclear war will, there'll be nothing left. And but I'm sorry we are where we are now.
What would be back on track for you? When you say back on track?
There's so many ways we're off track. I think to have homeless in this country, homeless families, is wrong. It's such a complicated situation. I think, again, that's for another time that we'll discuss all that. But it's a terrible, terrible state of affairs. Our economy, we have the haves and the have-nots, and the haves are not willing to sacrifice. They should not sacrifice for the have-nots. They've earned it. They've worked it. I think our tax system is so wrong. I think I almost think the vote should go to the landowners, you know, the way it used to be. I think that certainly might help. Restrictions with Congress.
What
term limits?
What would you do with the have-nots in that situation?
I think everyone's entitled to work. We need to get work for these people, but where is the work? It's being replaced by machines. I think we've created such a monster. The machines do the work that people used to do. I think our drug situation is out of control. It's just the whole thing is so complex. There are no easy answers, but I think we need some easy. We need to get some answers quickly. I think we. Why am I talking about this?
I
feel it's our criminal system, our judicial system is all wrong. It should not take 2 years to bring a criminal to trial. And our prisoners are treated better than the victims. Really, they have more rights in jail than the people that, the person that's been a victim that does not know how to access the system, the judicial system, is taken great advantage upon. It's terrible when you see someone, these helpless people, helpless blacks down in our city halls, they are on juries. They don't know how to get help, and they're taken advantage of, and the person that has committed the crime is taken care of, and we're not taking care of our victims at all. That whole thing needs to be rethought. We need punishment to fit the crime, and we don't punish the way we should. So I think our whole criminal justice, everything needs to be rethought. It needs to happen faster, and I think our punishments need to be much more harsh and much more public. And I think if they showed public hangings or executions on television, I used to think that was wrong, but I think it might be a deterrent, because I know that all these young children are watching so much television, and I'm talking about children, the poorest child in our country has a television set, and they will go out and commit crimes, but they don't recognize the fact that they will be punished. But if they could see a real punishment for someone that is stealing, or someone that injures, or someone that hurts, if they really could see what happens to a killer instead of going to jail for the rest of their life, if they could see an execution, if we would execute, but you see, we don't do that. It takes years and years.
And ties everything mm-hmm.
So I feel very strongly about that issue in particular.
Okay. Back to Sylvan Beach.
nice subject. Yes, it's staying.
What do you remember the maids at all up here?
Maids?
Yes. Do you have any memories about them?
I remember they were wonderful. There was a wonderful Nancy that Mrs. Pearson had forever. I just remember a lot of them, and they were wonderful people. I'm sorry they're not here anymore. I'm glad they're not, but it was a wonderful group of ladies, wonderful ladies.
And that they have their Thursday night off?
Yes, and they'd fish, and they were so jolly and happy, and they were so proud of their position.
Exactly. Did you ever notice, were there ever any problems with the black maids?
I don't remember. No.
In your memory, what are some of the most famous people that have come to Sylvan Beach? As a matter of fact, as I just asked, you had a famous house guest here a couple of years ago for a wedding, as I remember.
You see, I would never have thought of that unless you'd reminded me. Because, again, why don't you ask me a question? Because I don't want to just offer
that. can you name some of the famous people that have come to White Lake that you remember?
No. Okay. I can't.
Okay. But you did have a fellow up here by the name of Ross Perot a couple of years ago, didn't you?
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
He's a personal friend of yours.
He is.
Very good man, I understand. Very kind.
Oh, he's a fine man.
When Toby was sick, as I remember, he did a couple of very nice things for Tony. He flew to your house one day, as I remember, with a Sears.
Oh, yes. Do you want me to go and tell that story? Well, he's a personal friend of ours, and we've known him really before he was Ross Perot. We just knew him. I first became aware of Ross when this gentleman from Texas was trying to help find POWs from Vietnam. And then when we moved to Dallas in 1970, our children went to a small parochial church school, St. Michael's, and with our four children, they were in classes with a lot of the Perot children. They're five Perot children, and so a lot of our children were in the same classes with the Perot children. So our friendship was really evolved through the children, and we always we just always knew them in that manner. And then our friendship grew into we'd see them socially, and then we'd go skiing with them, and just enjoyed them so much. They are the type of family you can strip away the outer exteriors, and they're just as wonderful once you strip everything away as they are before you know what's inside. And when Toby got meningitis, Ross was very concerned, and he called in a team of doctors. He knew we were doing the right thing, but he said, "JoAnne and Tony, I don't know if time is our friend or time is our enemy. We have got to get some specialists here." We had specialists anyway that we had called in. We were comfortable with what Tony and I were doing, but Ross said, "I would feel more comfortable because I love him so much, and I'd feel more comfortable if we get so-and-so in." So he brought his another specialist in who concurred with ours. So, and then as time went on, Toby, we really didn't know that much about meningitis, and we thought once he got out of the hospital, he'd be fine. And it lingered and lingered. It's something that can stay with you for a long time. Toby, at that time, as you know, as I told you, was a fighter pilot, but he also was on reserve status, so he flew twice a week, and at that period of time was working for Ross Perot in his organization, part-time. And Toby was having a terrible, he just felt awful, and Ross, we knew Toby was not getting enough rest, so Ross, one Saturday morning, the doorbell rang, and I answered it, and there is Ross, and he said, come here, I want to show you what I have in the car. And he popped the trunk of his car, opened it up, and he pulled out one cot. He said, "Now, this is one bed, one cot. I want him to have it for the Dallas office. Here's another cot. This is for the Fort Worth office." So he has no excuse. Wherever he's working, in whatever office he's in, he is supposed to take a nap from 12 to 1 every single day. He also pulled out two blankets, two sheets, top sheet, bottom sheet, and two pillows and pillowcases. He said, "I have everything here but teddy bears." And he said, I'm setting up a set in my office. It's going to be in my file room." And he said, no one will disturb him. He said, "So that will be in the file room, and there'll be another set in the Fort Worth office. He is to report at 12 every day and sleep for an hour." And we just laughed. And he said, "I've been to Sears and I got these by myself." He said, "I waited in line. I paid for it myself. I didn't send anyone because I knew if I did it myself, Toby would be sure to use it." And I said, "I think he'd be sure anyway." So Toby did that for about 4 months, and he fell into a deep sleep every day at 12. And then Ross would wake him up at 1, or various secretaries would. But it was typical of the man.
To be that caring.
That caring.
He's a very great man.
Uh-huh. And he did come up to our daughter's wedding 2 years ago here.
Yes. Was he here very long?
He came Friday afternoon and left Sunday morning. Sat right in that chair.
Uh-huh. Get a picture of the chair.
Had a great time. He had a great time. He's such a team player and a great sport. And the day of the wedding, we had a lot of activities down on the beach. And Ross was just loved it and laughed and participated in some of the games. And had a wonderful time.
Oh, that's fantastic. Do you happen to remember by any chance the trumpet player?
Oh, the Reitz, John Reitz.
John Reitz, yeah.
Yes, I've mentioned Margot Reitz several times. And her older sister was Adele, who was Jean's age, and Margot was my friend. And then their father, John Reitz, would go out in his boat on a still night. You could hear this beautiful trumpet coming over. It just echoed throughout the whole area. It was marvelous.
You were on the side
of yes, the road. Yes, because we lived on this side, yeah. And we could hear it. It was beautiful.
Did he do that on a moonlit night, or was this any?
I don't know. He did not do it as often as we would have loved, because it was always such a special treat to hear him.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know how often he did it, Joe, but he'd do it. And I think it was always the conditions just had to move him. You know, the moon had to be out, and it would have to be nice and warm, and so he would just get in the boat. He still comes up here with his wife, Lois, and they've been married 60 years.
My God.
And they look wonderful. I saw them wandering around here a couple years ago.
For the final question, which may lead to more, what are the biggest changes on Sylvan Beach from the time you were young to now?
Well, of course, the Wabanango Club. We don't have that as it was. But we have another one. I think during those 2 years, we went down to Murray's Inn for our services. That was a definite change. We didn't realize how, we all knew how lucky we were just to be right here, you know, in our little own area for church. But that was a change. Other than the post office moving back and forth, and new tennis courts, and the Wabanango Club, I think it's remained, through my eyes and my heart, very unchanged.
Just things are the same. That's one of the beauties of the place.
I think so. And I do remember this house when the sidewalk that goes in front of all the houses, you know, Burroughs and Chilgren, Peterson, McFadden, used to extend all the way past Stewart's,
okay.
All the way to that hedge. And then the Stewart's on the inside of the sidewalk had a chain link fence with a gate. And they had morning glories growing up the fence. And I remember that so clearly because I loved the morning glories. And they had everything enclosed with chain link because of their boxers, so the boxers wouldn't get out. And then the next thing I know is the sidewalk wasn't here one summer. And it's because apparently the Stewarts would have endless procession of people parading by the house. And they were in a position, because their property is not in the association, they could take out their sidewalk. And then somehow the fence disappeared with the morning glories. I was sorry to see the morning glories disappear. But that was a change, and I think that happened in the early 50s when the chain link fence came out.
Okay.
I don't know.
Okay, let's just say that in 100 years this tape is going to be watched. Do you have any advice to give the future?
My Lord, I just hope it can be watched in 100 years, that we have not blown ourselves up in this world, and that people are still coming to this wonderful spot. Now, what was your question?
Oh, do you have any advice? Let's say that 100 years from now, do you have anything to say to those who come after you?
Oh, that's a very, very important, heavy question. I'm sure someone will answer that better. Just on a very light level, I think hopefully this place will be as lovely in 100 years as it is today, and I hope that people will cherish it as much as we have cherished it through the generations that I've been coming here and those that went before us, because it is unique. People who come here have been to beaches in the Italian Riviera, all over California, the Caribbean, beautiful Hilton Head, all, and Nantucket, Martha's Vineyard. they all say, this, you have a treasure here. And of course, without the people, we wouldn't have the spirit. So everyone has to never take advantage of the friends and the people that started this wonderful tradition of coming up. I hope that always remains and that they can cherish it as much as we have had. And take care of it, everyone. Take care of it.
clean
the beaches. Yes, it's been a gift. It's been quite a gift to have experienced White Lake.
I wonder why.
And Sylvan Beach. I wonder why too.
Are not in the ghetto.
I think it's God's grace.
Yeah.
That's all.
For some reason, He put us here, and not in a ghetto. And I don't know why, except that we better.
It could have been any of us, anywhere.
Yeah. Oh God, yeah. Yeah, and that's.
So
what we have to remember.
So this is a definite gift.
We didn't earn it.
It's a gift. But we are here. We have to protect it.
Yes. Oh yeah. It's part of us.
So that's all I would say.
Well, great. Well, thank you very much. Very fascinating.
Thank you.
It's been great. And again, if there's something you want to add, you want to remember something, call me, and I'll have your tape separate, and
thank
we'll
you.
Just add it on. So
good.
If there's anything you want, we'll do it. But thank you.
It's more than
enjoyable.
I have loved it. It has brought up a lot of memories.
You're great. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, Joe, for doing